We appreciate your cooperation. I shall now invite Dr. Mok Yu Ming on stage to start the forum proper. Dr. Mok is a senior consultant and chief of department of mood and anxiety in IMH. He established the Mood Disorder Unit, MDU, in 2016, which is an inpatient specialist service that provides assessment and treatment for complex or severe mood disorders. The MDU service is aimed at optimizing patients' recovery process that involves a customized combination of medication and therapies that are best suited for each patient. Dr. Mok, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for the forum. This is very special because it's our first public forum since the pandemic. And I think as Singaporeans, we all went through 2.5 years of almost isolation from each other, but not only from each other, from those that we care about. Bipolar disorder didn't go away. I mean, you know, MDU has been treating bipolar disorder since its inception, and it did not take a break in these 2.5 years. People with bipolar disorders, their caregivers still had to cope with it. They still had to deal with the isolation, the worries, the anxieties of this past 2.5 years. And today the government announced the end of all our vaccination differentiation measures. October 10th, everyone can go out, right? Regardless of whether you're vaccinated or not. It's almost like the pandemic is over. But the healthcare challenges, mental health challenges remain. Okay, it is, is even harder because everybody's out there is celebrating. We can go out and eat. There's no size restrictions. But bipolar disorder still stays. Caregiving of people with bipolar disorder still stays. And as we progress on past the pandemic, there's still geopolitical fears and worries. In this troubled world, we still have to come together. We still have to help each other. And we still have to learn to cope. So today's forum is about bipolar disorders. I hope you'll be able to stay for the full thing. The team has put in a lot of effort. We try to show different perspectives of coping and caring for people with bipolar disorders. And we sincerely hope that you enjoy it and you participate. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you, Dr. Mok. My name is Steve. So together with my team here later on, my panel of presenters, we have a group of experts on bipolar disorder. So we wish to, you know, walk you through the journey of bipolar disorder from multiple lenses. So first of all, just want to have a show of hands who think that this statement is correct. Bipolar disorder is rare. So there's no right or wrong. Just, you know, if you think that is the case, you can put on the hand, drop your hands. So none of us think it's rare. Okay, well, someone thinks it's rare. All right, okay. So in fact, that is a myth. So did you know that it's a leading cause of disability worldwide? 1.6% in Singapore, 1.6% of the adult population in Singapore will be or have been diagnosed with bipolar disorder in their lifetime. So put that into perspective, that's about 1 to 2 people in a packed SMRT double decker. All right, and what about this? Can put up your hands if you think mania sounds fun. It does sound fun, right, isn't it? Right, so it does sound fun. But did you know that people may feel ecstatic, energetic, with little need for sleep, but they can also be unpleasantly agitated, restless, a lot of negative consequences from their reckless decision-making as well. And that obviously can negatively affect a person's relationships. What about this? Bipolar disorder is nothing but mood swings and needs no medications, and the medications are addictive. Anyone? All right, you guys are right in the sense that the mood fluctuations are much more severe and persistent than the normal kind of moodiness that we all experience in day-to-day life. And they can cause problems in multiple facets of a person's life. And they tend to recur if left untreated. And the most of all prescribed medications are indeed not addictive at all. So now, what is bipolar disorder? So we talk about mood swings, right? All of us have mood swings because of our, you know, stresses in life. We have ups and downs. But then in bipolar disorder, these will be considered more extreme kind of mood episodes. So they can be either manic, hypomanic, or depressive episodes. The usual early onset will be that of adolescence or early adulthood to have the first episode of these mood episodes in bipolar disorder. And they are, as mentioned, persistent. They can be days, weeks, months, or sometimes even longer. And they can be, they're usually recurrent as well. So we're talking about more than half of them having more than one episode after having the first one. Or 25%, so that's one in four, having another episode in the same year. But this is probably underestimation because usually the studies don't go, you know, you can imagine they're not, the studies may not go beyond 2 years, for example. So these are likely underestimations. And often even if they're not considered to have major episodes, they still have some residual symptoms. You know, that's not considered a full-blown episodes, but they're still suffering from these residual symptoms. And they are severe with significant functional impairments that's in different aspects of their life. That could be academic, occupational, interpersonal. And they often come with risk-taking behaviors, overspending, taking drugs, alcohol. And some of them come with psychotic symptoms as well. So that's a departure, you know, being not in tune with what's real, what's not. And they come with a higher suicide attempts risk as well. So this is a busy slide. It shows the signs and symptoms of both depressive episodes as well as manic or hypomanic episodes. So it's just a showcase that, you know, a person with bipolar disorder can present different ways. So it can be any, you know, mixture of these symptoms. And, you know, it just to demonstrate that no two individuals with bipolar disorder are the same. Now, this is just an illustration of the mood journey that a person can go through. The words may not be too big, but if you can just sort of look at the green line, so that's, you know, what we expect in a life, you know, going through ups and downs, life stressors, but we're still, you know, functioning fine, we still carry on with our lives. But in bipolar disorder, you can see the mood swings can be much, much more severe and persistence or lasting longer as well. So that will cause a lot of problems in life, as you can imagine. And just some of the examples, you know, during the, for example, manic or hypomanic episodes, people can take do the, you know, carry out some of the risk-taking behaviors such as overspending or even falling in love or getting married. So, I mean, obviously that was a joke, but just to showcase that, you know, people do things that not of their character. So what exactly causes bipolar disorder? Well, we actually don't exactly know, but it is likely a combination of genetic, psychological, and as well as environmental factors. So there are, you know, hypotheses about chemicals imbalance in the brain. It could be physical illnesses that cause it. It could be medication or drug induced as well. And sometimes it's linked to some type of personality as well. And while it may not be purely caused by, but often triggered by stressful life events to have the first and as well as subsequent episodes. They often come with negative. So some of the factors that can actually perpetuate the bipolar disorder as well would be negative family environments or lack of social supports. And it's also often, co-occurring with other mental health disorders as well, such as anxiety, panic disorder, or substance use, as mentioned earlier. Well, how do you diagnose this? So it's usually, for both physical as well as psychiatric evaluation. The physical part is mainly to rule out other physical illnesses that may actually mimic bipolar disorder. So that will be looking into medical medication history, performing a physical examination, blood tests, and maybe brain imaging as well. But the main bulk of it will be the psychiatric evaluation. So that often involves a referral to a psychiatrist, assessment of the feelings, thoughts, and behaviors, and with the person's consent to explore further information from family and as well as their confidants. And sometimes a mood diary to document some of these mood fluctuations may help with diagnosis as well. So just to note, in Singapore, usually the treatment delay will be done over 4 years. So meaning that the person's only started getting treated 4 years after the first episode or first mood episodes. So that's the end of my first segment. I will hand over to my colleague, Ms. Yoko.
Thank you. afternoon, everyone. My name is Yoko. I'm the undergrad been working in the MDU. So I'll be presenting Picturing Bipolar, Channeling Emotions Through Creativity. In the MDU, we provide art therapy services to our inpatients and outpatients. So today I'm going to go through these three parts. What is art therapy, its benefits to the patients with bipolar disorder, and I'll also walk you through a case study. So what is art therapy? Art therapy is an integrative mental health profession that combines psychological theories, human experiences, and creative art-making process. We work towards enhancing and enriching the lives of individuals, families, and groups which have similar lived experiences. We work with the patients with visual means such as drawing, paintings, and for their self-reflection, understanding themselves. The art therapist is certified and to provide a safe holding space so that our patients feel safe to express themselves, their feelings, emotions, thoughts, and what do they feel about their disorder. So the visual means being our main communication tools, and then the therapeutic relationship as well. So there are some myths or misconceptions about art therapy. People say art therapist can diagnose the person through her artwork and the drawing. Can you give me a drawing and then say, oh, this is bipolar, this is schizophrenic? Actually, it's false. Art therapist's job is not to diagnose a person or his or her art. This is a doctor's work. But we use our observations and assessment through both verbal and nonverbal communication. That means the artwork and how the patients say about the artwork of their lived experiences and their illness. And then we can determine the therapy goals and to assess the therapy outcomes and progress. So there's a triangular relationship between the art therapies, the artwork, art materials, and also the patient. So there's also a saying that a person needs to be good at art to come for art therapy. It is also not true. You don't need to be good at art or have art experience to be benefited from art therapy. Because art therapy adopts a wide range of approach and materials, we use play, free associations, storytelling, and sometimes we make objects and then we can play with it like to mimic family relationships or relationship with the self. So now I'm going to talk about how does art therapy help our patients with bipolar disorder. Through the work with the patients in the mood disorder unit, I have come to realizing these three main aspects, which is number one, picturing bipolar. The image can be a guide. Number two, emotional processing through the nonverbal channel. Number three, the neuroscience of creativity and mindfulness. So I'll be also integrating my presentation with a case study. Thanks for one of our patients who generously shared about her artwork and her experience. So although this case does not represent many scenarios of our patient's experiences, I have selected her work because of the many artworks that she has done within art therapy and also outside art therapy. So it gives me a lot of content to be able to observe the patterns and compound this case study. So about ethics of art therapy, I have discussed with the patient and gotten consent how I should present her case. So thanks for this patient, generous sharing to advocates for mental health. So this case is about Madam Tan, who is a Singaporean Chinese lady in her late 50s. She's single and lives independently. She has been a private tutor teaching various subjects. Apart from work, she likes cooking, reading, writing, poem, and brisk walking. About her mental health history, she had 5 admissions in NUH before 2017, and in 2017, she was diagnosed with bipolar 1 disorder in IMH. And since then, she had 5 admissions, almost once per year. The presenting problems and challenges for Madam Tan was that because of the high moods and energies she experienced from bipolar disorder, she has always this emotional distress and she retreated to coping with defenses and also non-compliance with medication. That's why causing the yearly relapse and being hospitalized. And that would also have impaired her quality of life, not being able to work. So when she was referred to art therapy, my journey with her has been 2 times of inpatient group sessions, and then 17 times of outpatient art therapy sessions, individual sessions, and she has no artistic skills or experience before. So let us hear Madame Tan, what she says about her journey with bipolar disorder.
Thank you. So I'm so high that I always think I'm a great person and special person. But I think people who come to learn the internet and learn the code, otherwise it will go off scale. That it really breaks the personality of a life. So how do I deal with that all the time? I try to really, not want to be too high for myself and try to be mindful. For example, bipolar would make me spend a lot of money and buy a lot of things for a lot of people when they are buying. I buy things for a lot of people, but still a lot. I'm not sure that it works still.
Yeah, so you can hear from Madam Tan, there's a lot of coping challenges and also all of the normalcy when she's coping with the disorder. So now I'm going to talk about the effects of art therapy. First one, picturing bipolar, the image as a guide. Because that our patients create artworks, so these artworks become a record for them to be able to see and observe the patterns. From seeing through their artworks and images, they start to believe about their illness. So Madam Tan said, my images really sees the flow of thoughts in my mind that fluctuated my moods, and that's part of the symptoms to be a bipolar patient. So my work is really to guide and journey with the patient to observe these patterns in their images as records. And these images usually will show polarization of some sorts. The visual elements sometimes shows polarization in terms of the colors used, and also the lines, the textures, the good and bad, and high and low always combined in one picture. And so these patterns can be monitored to identify bipolar features and symptoms and their development. So as a result, this can also be help the patients to gain insights into their illness and towards more self-acceptance. This can also aid in early diagnosis and treatment of the bipolar disorder. So I'm going to share with you three artworks by Madam Tan, who sees these bipolar symptoms that she has been denying of the disorder for many years. And now that because of these three images, she started and she had now come to terms with this disorder. So when you look at this artwork, do you notice anything? Do you notice how the lines compose together? About the color use? Any patterns? Yeah. So Madam Tan says, my symptoms exhibited through my trends of thoughts, my action, my behavior, and my projections into the drawings. So in this drawing, you can see the contrasting colors, the green and the red, and also the many, many patterns of horizontal and vertical patterns, which repeat itself. The long, short, short, long, short, short, long, short, short patterns, right? Our patients also experience symptoms which are cyclical and repetitive. In the next drawing, Madame Tao always creates poems. So this is a poem called Night Words. She created in the middle of the night without sleep. In the last two sentences, she discovered it has kindness and lowness in her. These two lines, if I may speak, Hao Yan Zhuang Yu, Shu Hu Qing, Li Chou Pei Shu, Dao Wei Qing, translated as in, there are countless and unlimited grandiose thoughts and very great speech, but at the same time, she feels depressed and also very sad. Yeah. So she can identify these high and low positive and negative elements in her heart and also herself. So this next one, when you look at the drawing, you see a horse probably, right? Do you see another animal being combined into one picture? Let's hear what Madam Tan talks about this picture.
Yeah, I'm drawing shows from the 20 feet simple
So she said, if she hasn't had the kindness, she don't think she can deliver such an intricate painting. So that's why she really cannot hide that from being a bipolar patient. And after looking through this series of artworks with me, she started to accept her illness. So apart from some images that have shown both the polarization of some sort, there are also other images when the patients experience like in a depressive phase or a manic phase. So we also discover pictorial qualities or elements that are found in images. For example, these two during depressive phase for our patients. What do you notice again? Yes, they are rather simple. There are a lot of white spaces, almost like very low energy, and the lines are not pressured. Yeah, but they do have a framework. They do have a picture to tell. It's very simple, almost like very childlike. So now, let's look at the images created by patients during the manic phase. Take a look at the differences between these images and two that I have just shared with you. So these are created by Madame Tan during her normal days and just before hospitalization. Yeah, that was a relapse during her manic phase. She said she created this during her like sleepless nights. Yeah. So my energy level is extremely high and I can just sleep 2 to 3 hours a night. And that can stretch for a duration of 1 week. And when that comes, I become topsy-turvy. After a week of less sleep or 2 or 3 hours, my energy becomes so high that I become illogical. Sometimes I get very confused and I produce very messy drawings and it makes no sense. So she started to see, like, flip through her journals. There were a lot of drawings just before that hospitalization because she didn't take her medication. So through the journey of art therapy, we look through her journal, art therapy, art images. She realized these are the images where she are actually experiencing those manic symptoms. You can see the images, right? There are a lot of overlapping layers. The compositions are almost like illogical. It doesn't make sense. There's not a coherent picture in it. So, yeah. By observing the patterns in the images created by patients with bipolar disorder, we can help them to monitor and manage the symptoms. So there are some patterns that we can identify. For example, just now you've seen in those examples, images created during manic phase are usually overloaded with pains and strokes, or maybe worse. So they are multi-layered. They are also sometimes with playful, childlike, and very abstract. And the patients in our sessions usually cannot stop. You give them 1 hour, they can create for 1 hour. You give them 1 day, they can also create non-stop. Well, for our patients going through a depression phase, we can also observe that they seldom finish one drawing, no matter how long is the session. And in their drawings, it's usually very difficult for them to be engaged in the task. And there's this psychomotor retardation. The coloring is very soft, and they even just ask, well, can I just do coloring? Yeah, or maybe they'll lie down on the table. There's very little pressure that they use on the materials, and there's a large amount of empty space in the drawings. Sometimes, because of the depression, they will also produce images that have haunting representations and suicidal features. So next, I'm going to share with you emotional processing. After we look through the images as a guide, how do art therapies help our patients to process the emotions during those difficult times through the nonverbal expressions? Yeah. So this is a process from externalization to internalization. What does it mean? When we make art, we can, like, for example, we say emotions. When I tell you how angry I am, how frustrated I am, I can say, I'm very angry. Yeah. Or maybe, I don't want to work today. I feel so stressed. Sometimes work can be limited, especially for our patients with bipolar disorder. When they are in that kind of high and low and manic and depression stage, the emotions are really very hard to express. It's so complicated. It really needs another language for them to share how they feel, their experience. So we use art as a form of communication, as a form of language. Yeah. When I can share my anger with a picture, maybe a picture of a volcano or maybe pounding the clay, so that we can then give it meanings. And it is also safer for our patient because we don't need to always talk about it. Yeah. So there's no judgment of our artwork as well. There's no right or wrong for our artwork, right? Yeah. So the art therapist can also hold a space for the client, the patient, to look at the artwork. Are there different perspectives to look at this volcano or to look at this flower as in they are representing a certain experience, the complicated emotions? So we first choose the nonverbal means of making art, images, is the externalizing the emotions first. This is an example by Madam Tan. When I explore with her her emotions journeying through bipolar disorder, she created this image and she said, "In the facade of the self, I may be seasoned, old and ill." She's always like very tough and very seasoned outside. She don't want to accept or tell people that she's a patient. So she said, "I become very suspicious of people who talk to me, whether they want to harm me or they deny me of my credential. But inside is the gentleness, gentle heart." So you can see from the image, right? On the left side is those emotions that she always present to other people externally. Yeah, it's just high and low, you know, big and you know, small and you know, depressed or maybe very aggressive kind of emotions. But inside, there's actually more textures, more layers to these emotions. So on the right, you can see from this image, she used the materials such as the soft pastels, smudging it, and also putting some feathers to add to the representations of her emotions, to be able to understand the difference and also articulate her experience more accurately. So after she shared with me her emotional facade, I continue to think about how to help her to even internalize these and make sense and make meanings of these for her. So I used a material, which is a paper mask, to help her to really let it out, to express how do you feel to be a bipolar patient. She said, "I was very angry. I was very frustrated and the doctors giving me medications. I am in denial mode." So you see, she after she painted the mask, she has this need to put on tissue paper. "This is me, this is me. And I also feel very small. I don't dare to tell people. I was scared because I don't want my siblings to think that I'm mad or they deny me of my credential." This is how she felt as a bipolar patient. So I continue to work on that with her to help her to open up and to see that our emotions can be shared. So how do you feel to share your feelings with your family? So she started to ponder and make changes to the artwork. "Yes, sometimes I can be brave and open up that facade." And she thinks that after this draw, this creation, she started to realize, "I'm thankful for my family, although it comes in very hard, because supporting a patient with bipolar disorder can stand out of the normalcy of the family's members' routine. But they were very supportive of me to want me to get back my confidence, step out to go back to society to work again. I come to realization that they are trying to help me also." So she comes to realization that, yes, I can share my emotions, yeah, when I'm ready and I have other people to support me. So to summarize, art therapy is a process between externalization to the right brain activity, which is the art making activities using image. We don't need to talk about, but emotions, more especially stronger emotions, are stored in the right brain. So when we use art making, creating images. It is actually a right brain process. Then we try to get it out first. When we talk about our work, it's actually an internalization using language. So language is a left brain process. So there's an integration. This integration will mean making sense of the lived experiences and the illness. Okay. So last, after channeling the emotions through the difficult times, bipolar disorder, as the doctor said, right, is a chronic condition. How do we live with it? So art making depends on creativity and mindfulness. So I think a lot of our patients with bipolar disorder, not only about the challenges of coping with the symptoms and the illness, it's also about their identity. Oftentimes our patients will think that they are just a patient, and they think that, who am I apart from this patient's self? So in art therapy, my main job, perhaps the most important job, is to create and strengthen their self-identity so that they can continue to live with a bipolar disorder, to find themselves and see the sense of self for themselves. So these two aspects of art making, I would say, is the creativity and mindfulness practice. Yeah. So I have talked about patients with chronic illness often experience a lack of autonomy and control because they have to take medications, they have to come to hospitals. It's like something that is out of their control. It may weaken their self-esteem and self-identity from time to time. So a mother of a young patient with bipolar says, "My child with this disorder sometimes may lose self-confidence, feel depressed, like living in a shadow, gradually losing self-esteem." Another adult patient says, "Even when I was fighting with my husband, so many I seemed to be flying, there was a part of me that dispassionately observed what was going on and knew it was crazy. I said, 'Self, you're nuts.'" So they come, many times they come and blame themselves. "It is because of me." Yeah. So by doing art, yeah, we tap on that part of me, which is the creative self. Many studies have actually shown that patients with bipolar disorder, when they experience these high energies and symptoms, when they are managing the symptoms, actually they can create very, very creative work. The academic and social productivity may also be increased. So why not, you know, take these vulnerabilities or symptoms as a strength? In art therapy, we guide our patients to continue to channel these energies and emotions into constructive and creative work. It would help our patients to rewire their thinking pattern. And making art is like a problem solving. When you take the paints, when we take a clay, you need to know how to work on it. It's helping our patients to find their strengths and discover new possibilities when they make new images and new artworks. So at the end of the day, we help them to explore self-identities, their own voices, values. Art making is also a mindfulness practice because art making is a moment-to-moment, breath-to-breath, stroke-by-stroke process. When you pick up the brush, you paint from the first line, next line, and then continue this. It can be guided by the art therapist so that the process will be very mindful. And this helps our patients to be able to connect to themselves, to their bodily emotions, to their awareness of their thoughts, their thinking pattern. So in art therapy, we can also incorporate mindfulness like yoga or meditation in the art making. So it helps the patients to calm their anxiety and depression. It also manage their irritability, raise awareness of their thinking patterns and desires. When they are so calm, it also can help to rewire the brain. We think about themselves, who I am, right? What are the other self aspects that I have, and to cultivate self-compassion and wholeness. I would like to end my presentation by this self-portrait created by Madame Tan, and this is me. So she says, "After I do my drawing, I gain back my confidence. Tell yourself what you're going to do. Talk to someone, go back to the team who is knowledgeable and someone whom you trust and able to accept who you are. Listen to you and affirm you and to build you up. Now I see bipolar as a part of me. I've got to live with it. Just be confident just persevere. This is a self-portrait that comes from Madam Tan. You can see very different from the past images, right? She now uses a lot of mindfulness practice, color pencils, and spend a lot of time slowly and very mindfully create her images and to be more connected to her emotions, her thoughts. So to summarize my presentation, how does art therapy work to support and benefit patients with bipolar disorder in these three areas? Picturing the bipolar, the image as a guide to help us accept and gain insights into the illness and manage our symptoms. Second, process our emotions through the nonverbal channels, nonverbal expressions, externalize it and then internalize as self-insights and self-awareness. Lastly, to cope with and live with the bipolar disorder with creativity and mindfulness practice. It can help the bipolar patients with bipolar disorder to create and strengthen their identity. Thank you very much. I'll pass back the mic to Dr. Lin.
Thank you,
Yoko. So, our next speaker is supposed to be Dr. Lee Yuwei. Unfortunately, he's unable to make it today, so I'll be presenting on his behalf. So we're looking at tackling bipolar disorder. So the title will be a multi-pronged approach, and my segment is on a biological approach. So perhaps just a bit about the treatment approach for bipolar disorder. As with most mental illnesses, we're looking at biological, psychological, as well as social approaches of treatment. So my segment is mainly focused on biological. So that'll be medications, neurostimulations, and then obviously together with regular follow-up with doctors, and as well as maintaining a healthy lifestyle. The psychological part and the social parts, I'll leave it to my colleagues later on. So first of all, medications. Whenever we're looking at bipolar disorder, we're looking at the phase kind of dependent approach, and I'll explain a bit about that. But generally speaking, we're looking at when a person is going with bipolar disorder, going through an acute relapse phase, as opposed to perhaps following that, the maintenance phase. We're targeting the predominant symptoms of bipolar disorder, balancing whether we need to act quickly to resolve the symptoms versus the possibility of side effects from the medications. And often persons with bipolar disorder will require long-term kind of a treatment for most of them anyways, but it's not always the case. In terms of depressive episodes, in general, the goal is to treat that acute phase. So when a person's exhibiting all these depressive symptoms, we're aiming to resolve these symptoms. And the treatment guide usually is similar to those with non-bipolar depression, which is what we call major depressive disorder, or just simply depression. The primary goal is to have remission of these symptoms, of these depressive symptoms, and then for them to return to a normal level of psychosocial functioning, which is considered their baseline. The common medications include antipsychotics, mood stabilizers, and as well as antidepressants. Manic as well as or hypomanic episodes, the primary goal, again, similar, is to control those symptoms. And again, to allow them to return to a normal level of psychosocial functioning. And again, we need to see how fast we need to control these symptoms. Often we're looking at the symptoms of agitation or aggression, because they can be particularly risky to both themselves as well as others. And the usual medications for manic or hypomanic episodes would be that of antipsychotics, sedatives, as well as mood stabilizers. Now, after acute phase, we're looking at the maintenance phase. So maintenance phase, there are multiple goals actually. So aside from, preventing the obvious relapse again, we need to, earlier on I mentioned in my first talk, is that they often have residual symptoms or sub-threshold symptoms, meaning that they have symptoms of still have symptoms of depression, mania or hypomania that is not severe enough to be considered a full-blown episodes, but nonetheless, they're still symptomatic. So the maintenance phase is also aiming to reduce these symptoms as well. On top of that, the reduction of the suicide risk, the aims, and as well as reducing the frequency of these episodes, again, improving the functioning as well. The most common medications used during this maintenance phase will be that of mood stabilizers, and some of the examples will be lithium or sodium valproate. Side effects-wise, as you can imagine, or you may know, most medication have a long list of potential side effects. I mean, you can just take out your phone, Google side effects of paracetamol, you get a bunch of them. But these are potential side effects, and most of them, just like when you take paracetamol, do not experience any. And if they do, some of the common side effects, for example, of antidepressants include nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, etc. These are usually at the initial phase. So once your body, get used to the medications, then these side effects usually goes away. So aside from medications, the neurostimulation, as mentioned earlier, is another type of biological approach. And two of the common ones, methods that we're looking at would be electroconvulsive therapy, which is essentially a type of therapy that's done under general anesthesia, passing a very small amount of electric currents through the brain to sort of change or help with the brain chemistry to help the person's suffering from depressive or manic episodes. Repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation will be another newer type of neurostimulation that is basically stimulating part of the brain using magnetic pulse. And these type of these areas of the brain is hypothesized to be causing these depression as well as mania symptoms. So that's the end of my second part of my talk, and I'll hand over to my colleague, Ms. Tammy.
Hello, everyone. Hello, everyone. My name is Tammy, and I'm a psychologist. So today, I'll be focusing my segment on cognitive behavioral therapy for bipolar disorder. Okay, so there are generally two broad categories of treatment for bipolar disorder. As we have heard from Dr. Steve earlier, one category is medication, which is the first line of treatment for bipolar disorder. It helps with the stabilization of mood and the management of acute episodes. The other category would be psychosocial interventions, and they are used as adjuncts to pharmacotherapy. It helps to further stabilize symptoms, prevent relapses, and restore quality of life and functioning. So as we do know, bipolar disorder is a chronic condition that has a high risk of relapse and may cause psychosocial consequences. Right. So individuals with bipolar disorder may struggle with psychosocial consequences of previous episodes of mania and depression. So, for example, legal, social, emotional, or even interpersonal difficulties. They may struggle with the adherence of medication, perhaps due to concerns of side effects or even the fear of stigma. In fact, research has shown that about 50 to 60% of individuals with bipolar are either partially or completely non-adherent to medication after their first acute episode, right? And this is worrying because we know that non-compliance to medication is often associated with higher risk of relapse, hospitalization stays, and even suffering the implications, right? We also do know that the chronicity of bipolar disorder results in ongoing vulnerabilities for future episodes, where individuals may be concerned about future occurrences of future episodes, right? They might also suffer from significant residual symptoms and mood instabilities between episodes, which may cause, impairments in academic functioning or occupational functioning. So given the struggles that individuals with bipolar disorder face, there is definitely a role for psychosocial interventions. Right? Psychosocial interventions can increase the understanding of the illness and improve adherence to medication. They can help to manage subsyndromal symptoms, decrease the likelihood and severity of future episodes, improve functioning in between episodes, as well as to reduce distress. So I'll be talking about the first psychosocial intervention, CBT, and my colleagues Renice and Vera will be talking about other psychosocial approaches later in their talk. CBT is recommended as a second line of treatment following in addition to medication, and it aims to ease the depressive and elevated mood episodes by enhancing adherence to medication and teaching them how to identify early warning signs in order to prevent future episodes. Research has shown that it is effective in the treatment of acute depression and in preventing recurrences and in prolonging the period of remission. CBT can be delivered individually or in a group format. So here in IMH, we do offer individual CBT sessions as well as PsychUp, which is a group CBT program. Okay, so I'll be taking you through a typical patient's journey in CBT, right? And we'll first often start off with the assessment phase, where we aim to explore the context of the triggering factors of the patient's bipolar disorder, right? We would discuss the symptom profile, the different types of symptoms that the patient faces, right, and the impairments to the different domains of their life. We will then create a formulation to understand what might be maintaining their bipolar disorder and discussing treatment goals. So when we talk about formulation, these are the four different components that we often look at. We look at what are the thoughts, the emotions, the physiological responses, as well as the behaviors that the person has whenever they go through an episode. Right? If we actually take a look at all these four components, we would notice that they're all interconnected. This is because the way we think would affect how we feel, and affect how we feel in our body, right? And this would in turn affect the way we choose to act. So let's take a look at an example, right? So this is an example of someone who might be going through a depressive episode, right? And let's imagine, right, for this particular person, right, he may be terminated from a job because of his episode, right? What might be going through in his mind is that he might be thinking, you know, hey, I was subjected to injustice and I will never find a job again. This is likely to lead to feelings of unhappiness, anxiety, and anger, right? Which may be manifested as fatigue and exhaustion. So this person is likely to be very tempted to stay in bed, right? Just give up looking for another job, not wanting to answer phone calls, and just withdrawing socially. In that moment, right, that person might be feeling a relief in anxiety, right? Because, you know, just avoiding everything, right, is less stressful for that person. But if we take a closer look, right, this may not be very helpful because doing some of these things is likely to make it even more difficult for this person to find a job, right? So this might further reinforce this person's belief that I will never find a job again. And in CBT, what we aim to do is to break this vicious cycle that may be unhealthy, right, through cognitive as well as behavioral interventions, which I'll be talking more about later. So the next stage is psychoeducation, where we would educate patients about the nature and symptoms of bipolar. We would explain the treatment model in relation to the formulation that we have developed with the patient in the assessment phase. Right? Even though psychoeducation is often introduced after assessment, I would say it's typically done throughout CBT, wherever it's relevant, appropriate, or necessary. Okay, so for psychoeducation, it aims to foster a clear rationale as to why patients should adhere to and remain in treatment. It empowers individuals to gain a better understanding of his or her illness, recognize and manage symptoms, resolve stressful situations, and adhere to medications. So there are different levels in psychoeducation, and the first level is really about building awareness of bipolar disorder. Right? We provide information or to help the patient understand more about bipolar, right, to help them recognize early warning signs. We also discuss the importance of adherence to treatment so that they can remain compliant to the treatment. The next level would be to provide information to help them develop healthy, adaptive coping skills. So we discuss stress management, you know, the importance of avoiding substance use, the adaptation of healthy lifestyle, healthy sleep habits, regularity of habits, as well as the prevention of self-destructive behaviors. So the next stage would be really active interventions, where we'll be talking about behavioral interventions and cognitive interventions. Okay, so as part of behavioral interventions, what we want to do is first help patients to monitor their mood, their sleep, and their medication. This is to ensure that patients are aware of their mood changes and how it may be affected by the amount of sleep that they get and or adherence to medications. Right, so this is a mood chart, right, that we often get our patients to monitor. I know it's a bit small there, but I'll just go through. Right, so over there, you'll be able to actually monitor how your mood is. Right? We might even want to pay attention to anxiety and anger because sometimes this might come up during those episodes. We also want to track the amount of sleep that they have each day, as well as whether they take medication. So doing this helps the patient to understand how mood might fluctuate in relation to the amount of sleep that they get, as well as whether they are adherent to medication, and tracking some of these patterns would also help them to understand, you know, when they might be getting, you know, when they might be getting the next episode and to seek help or do some coping before things escalate. The other handout that I often use with my patients is really this sleep hygiene handout. Right. In the depressive phase, we often encourage patients to actually practice very good sleep hygiene to improve their sleep. Right. And in the mania phase, what we want to do is encourage them to increase the amount of sleep that they get. Right. So over here, you know, this is a typical handout that we have. If it's too small, I'll just read out just very briefly. This is quite a busy slide. Right. It talks about how you can take care of your body, you know, how you can engage in physical exercises, sleep only during the day, how you can maintain a good, you know, healthy bedtime routine, you know, how you can cope with bad dreams, if any, and how you can make your bedroom a more pleasant place to sleep. Yeah, another behavioral intervention that we often do is activity planning, right? We do know that patients in a depressive episode, they might experience procrastination, they might socially isolate themselves, or they may prefer to just stay in bed for the whole day. As we know, this is not very helpful. So we want to encourage them to engage in pleasurable activities that might give them a sense of mastery and achievement, right? We might also encourage them to engage in physical exercises because we do know that physical exercises can reduce depressive symptoms, increase functioning, as well as increase the quality of life. In the mania and hypomania episode, we might encourage them to increase the amount of sleep that they get. Right, they might look through their own, you know, sleep monitoring chart and realize that maybe they're getting too little sleep, right? And really find ways to increase the sleep. We might restrict, you know, going out at night so that they can really spend the nighttime sleeping. We might also introduce, you know, ways to tighten money management, right? Where they might set a budget, whether it's a monthly budget or a weekly budget, or even getting a trusted individual to restrict purchases, especially for big items. Right, we might slow down making important decisions. For example, you know, for very big decisions like life-changing decisions or, you know, decisions that involve very high financial commitment, we might want to make the decision only after getting enough sleep for two consecutive days or even after consulting at least two trusted individuals. We want us to also slow down impulsive behaviors. For example, we could remind ourselves that we want to think for at least 5 seconds before acting, or even discussing with people first, right? And the last one relates to stimulus regulation. We want to avoid stimulus that may be associated with elevated mood or dysphoria. Yeah, so the other component that we often do is also problem-solving skills. This is actually helpful for people who struggle with, you know, doing things that they are supposed to do, but especially during the depressive phase. Right? So these are the 6 steps for problem-solving. Right. First is really identifying the problem, right? Brainstorming all possible solutions, regardless of its feasibility and difficulties, right? And then evaluating the pros and cons of each of the solution. Eventually, you will choose one solution, implement the solution, and then evaluate the results of the solution. You may then alter the solution, either partially or completely, whenever necessary. So as a psychologist, I often, you know, do this with my patient. We go through the problem together, right, to actually help them understand each step properly. And once they are able to understand each step, we will slowly wean off, right, and to help them, you know, address the problem, to actually solve the problem on their own, right, so that they can do this independently. Okay, the next intervention is cognitive interventions aimed to address cognitive bias in bipolar disorder. So during the depressive episode, you know, they might have negative beliefs about themselves, the world, the environment, and the future. So for example, they might have thoughts that I'm not lovable, you know, things are hopeless. And on the other hand, right, during the mania or the hypomania phase, they might have a different kind of thinking pattern, where they might have a very unrealistic positive beliefs about themselves, the world, and the future. They might be thinking that I'm better than everyone else, you know, and I can do whatever I want. So in cognitive interventions, we want to teach them how to learn to how to handle their thoughts in terms of rationality, right? So we want to actually make them think through the objective evidence, right? When they think about a thought, whether it's true versus not true, right? We want to do the appropriateness test. You know, what would someone else in this situation say, right? Is there a different explanation to this situation, right? And the last one is functionality test. We want to get them to look beyond just the immediate consequences. We want to get them to think a little bit about both the short-term and long-term consequences for their behaviors. Okay, so the last stage is relapse prevention, where we want to empower patients to continue their compliance with medications. We want to help them to identify early warning signs, continue the regulation of their daily rhythm, and to continue to self-monitor. Yeah, so just to add on the last level, which is relapse prevention, right? We want to utilize their past experience, review them in order to, you know, reduce the psychosocial consequences that episodes cause. Right? These will help to improve interpersonal and social functionality and to help them better deal with the residual symptoms, right? In order to promote wellness and quality of life. Okay, so in addition to psychoeducation, we want to reinforce the newly learned cognitive and behavioral techniques, right? Encourage them to practice more and use more often, right? We want to do emergency planning for challenging situations. So for example, in a mania, right? They might be, you know, handing over their credit cards to their spouse to help them manage. You know, in a depressive episode, they might want to get a friend to actually join them in activities, right, so that they can be held accountable in the times that they're so tempted to just stay in bed the whole day. Right? We also want to help them to learn early signs of mood episodes and use appropriate coping strategies as much as possible. Right, so as I draw close to my segment, right, I wanted to remind us that everybody's recovery journey is different. Right? Over here, I've got an excerpt of a story by someone struggling with bipolar disorder. Right? And if you look at the text, you know, she talks about how she has difficulties accepting, you know, her diagnosis. It is indeed difficult for someone to accept that they've got a chronic mental health condition, right? So, you know, in her journey, it might be very different, right? The, you know, the CBT journey may not be as straightforward as what we've presented earlier on. Sometimes we might need to deviate from it, sometimes because they might have difficulties really fully engaging in the CBT treatment. Right, so what we want to do is really validate their emotional experience, right? And what we might do is really, you know, help them to grieve over the loss of a healthy self, right? Developing the acceptance of the illness and really transitioning, right, towards having the illness as part of their identity. Right. So with that, I thank you, and I'll invite Ranis up the stage. Thank you.
Thank you, Tammy. So good afternoon, everyone. Today, my sharing will be on psychosocial interventions, finding stability through routines. So this is the contents overview. I'll first be sharing on what exactly occupational therapy is, bipolar and the significant relationship of bipolar and routines. We have a short activity time, which I believe most of you guys would have received this paper when you came in for registration, and understanding this activity through the use of understanding time use and concluding with a case study. Okay, so first, what exactly is OT? OTs aim to help individuals overcome their functional problems associated with their mood disorder through occupational-centered interventions, and secondly, to mobilize for social inclusion and adaptability. Let me break it down for you guys. Okay, so examples of occupation-centered can include self-care, routine, vocational training, work-life balance, and coping with one's roles such as son, father, and even a worker. And for social inclusion, we look at if they are socially isolated or withdrawn, or if they do need any sort of social support. And in terms of adaptability, how are they coping or adapting with their illness between the roles and the environment that they might be living in? So these are all the areas that we'll be focusing on during our interventions. So bipolar and routines. There's much research showing that individuals with bipolar have very much vulnerable changes to their circadian rhythms, which in simpler terms can be known as the body clock. And this will in turn affect their ability to function in their daily activities. Circadian rhythms are physical, mental, and behavioral changes that revolve this 24-hour cycle clock. Many areas of functioning, such as sleep, wakefulness, meals, and daily self-care activities are very closely tied to this regular 24-hour cycle. So many present with much difficulty in adapting to and may develop full-blown episodes in response to these changes in their body clock. Hence, one of the more common interventions that we look at is to target in building a routine that is balanced, structured, and to minimize these changes in their body clock. So before we go into the activity proper, let me show some evidence on routine building. So various studies have shown that reinforcing regularity in our clients' daily routines are shown to reduce their mood symptoms and the risk of manic or depressive episodes. Routine building have been shown effective in reducing the frequency episodes of mania or depression, and clients also reported that they have a faster recovery period from their depressive episodes. So exactly what is routine building? So it's time for our short activity, and let us give more insight into what routine building is. So if you all don't have the piece of paper, right, my colleagues will be around to give out to you. Just give them a wave and we'll just do this activity together. Yeah. Okay, so you should receive this paper with a wheel. We call it the occupational time wheel. So essentially we use this during sessions to show our patients that there are many different life areas that forms our routine. So let me explain to you these four life areas. It can be found at the bottom of the page. So the four life areas are productivity, play, self-care, and rest. So productivity can be defined as, you know, your work, your causes, housework, or even volunteering activities. So play is something that we do for fun, you know, things that we enjoy, our leisure activities. Self-care looks at grooming, you know, our bathing, our daily meals, and personal hygiene. And our rest can be afternoon naps or nighttime sleep. Okay, so we do acknowledge that there are some activities that might overlap between two areas. So for example, some might perceive cooking as productivity, whereas some might perceive it as self-care. But not to worry, this is a very subjective, there's a subjective element to it as to how our activities are categorized. But take some time for us to fill up your own routine. You know, think of a typical day and fill it up based on the time wheel. Usually we have four different colors for our patients, but for logistically restrictions, we don't have so many colors to pass around today. So we can only provide you all with a pen or a pencil, but not to worry. Take some time to fill up your own time wheel, and then we'll give a little bit of sharing as to what some of our clients' time wheel look like. Let's take about 2 to 3 more minutes to fill up your time wheel, and I'll continue on with the sharing. Okay, let me proceed on with the sharing. So for the occupational time wheel, some people also call it balanced time wheel, it's used as a visual illustration, as a kind of a visual aid for our patients to see, you know, how much time do they spend in a certain area. I think there's a small error on the slide. If you see, there's yellow, and that's to indicate productivity. I think the color got changed. Yeah, but not to worry on that. Thank you for participating in the activity. For those that took part, do take a look at your own time wheel. Does yours look similar to any on the screen? Do you feel that you're over or under occupied, or is your routine considered just right and balanced? So let's take a look at the wheel on the left first. So this person, he sleeps for about 12 hours a day. There's 10 hours of playtime and 2 meals a day. So many would consider this routine as underoccupied without any productivity work, and there's no regularity in the meals. Whereas if you take a look on the wheel on the right, it's a representation of many adults holding on to a 9-to-5 job with a good 8 hours of sleep. So typically most would consider this as just right, a balanced routine. Well, that might not be necessarily true, because routine building not only looks at the 4 life areas, but also looks at other factors, which I will elaborate more on the next slide. So how can we define what exactly is balance in routine? It can be defined as the organization of daily activities in a manner that enables health and well-being, allowing for variation in participation in the 4 life areas that we just mentioned: productivity, play, self-care, and rest activities. However, there are 2 dimensions that I would like for us to consider today. One, which is the individual subjective experience. Second, it's the interpersonal aspect of things. So for the individual experience, we can look at the individual's perspective. How do they feel about their own routines, and what do they value in life? Whereas for the interpersonal perspective, it creates the awareness that much of our routine affects and is affected by others. Most of the time is being shared between our family members or even the larger community that we live in. For example, mothers with children with special needs, much of their routine is looking at the treatments that they undergo with their children. Hence, when building routines of our clients, we not only look at these 4 areas, but also take into consideration the values that they have, the roles that they are undertaking in the family and the larger community. Okay, so I have a case study for us to illustrate this further. So Madam H is a 40-year-old lady with a diagnosis of bipolar 1 disorder, and she stays with her husband and 2 children. So let us see her time wheel when she was first in contact with us. Her current routine consisted of 13 hours of work. She works as a taxi driver in the morning and a part-time waitress in the afternoon and evenings. We can see that she spent most of her waking hours at work. However, there's only 3 hours of self-care, which we can see that most of her days do not have a lunch break, and that she takes her meals very irregularly, with mostly late dinners starting at about 10 to 11 in the night. Because she's a part-time, she has also 8 hours of sleep. Because she's a part-time waitress, so she has pretty much the same routine both weekdays and weekends, which is very different from typically us working adults who have more rest and more play over the weekends, where we rest and recharge, but not so much for Madam A. So during intervention, we explored the importance of play and self-care, and also attempted to understand her own perspective of work. She then shared that she tends to be someone who is always giving to others. Her strength is through acts of service, and she enjoys, you know, serving and impacting the life of people around her. She also has 2 children whom she needs to support, and she enjoys doing volunteering jobs by cooking for others. However, there are times when she felt tired and she felt she needed time for herself. Hence, we asked for her to place this in her routine so that she has more consistent time for self-care to build herself up so that she can care for others more and provide for her family. She also shared that, you know, the structure of having regular meals in the ward during her inpatient stay, she felt that her body is stronger and healthier, which is something that she would like to carry after she gets discharged. So this is the after a few sessions with her, this is the after balance wheel that we created. So we can see that there's more play and self-care time, where under play she chose and self-care, she chose to listen to calming music and take more walks in the park first thing in the morning and before bedtime. She also chose to have intentionally put in the lunchtime in the middle of the day so that she can have more regularity in her meals. Her productive work from 13 hours, she reduced it to 9 hours without compromising the need to support her family and while keeping the 8 hours of sleep. So in comparison, this is the before and after will, and we can see that she can still find a balance without compromising the value in her work and also understanding the importance of self-care to recharge so that she's able to sustain in all this productivity work in the long run. This in turn help increase her satisfaction and balance in her routine, hoping to increase the stability of her bipolar illness and reducing her risk of relapse. So this is the end of my presentation. These are my references. Thank you. So let's now welcome Mr. Phil, our mental health advocate, to share his story.
All right, good afternoon. My name is Phil, and this is going to be a bit weird because typically my outreach talks and my youth talks are 5 minutes of an intro, a quick summary, and then we go to a Q&A. But I've been told that the Q&A is all at the end. So I'm Phil. I live with bipolar disorder. I was pretty young when I was diagnosed, but I think the symptoms were pretty apparent. As early as I would say primary six, sec one, sec two, the symptoms were there. And I think I would be something or someone that you would call a high functioning individual. I think throughout history, there have been individuals with bipolar disorder on a spectrum. You have high functioning individuals, you have individuals who show barely any symptoms, and you have individuals who are on the extreme end. I think for me, I was pretty lucky to not be on the super extreme end, but also in that sense, I was more towards the middle side of things. I've seen Dr. Mock before for the longest time now. So before he had white hair. And before he was the Tylo of the affective mood disorder unit. Essentially, I'm 30 now, so that gives you a bit of a perspective. I work in the video games industry in esports, if you know about esports. And I'm also, in my spare time, an international referee for rugby. I think I was in the part of time chronologically where if you exhibited any symptoms of mental health, you are either crazy, retarded, or just stressed out. And stigma was still pretty high at that time. I think this is back in, I would say anywhere from 2004, 06, 08. And I think at that time, the climate was very different. Mental health care was also very, very different and very conservative. And I think even among the medical community, it was pretty restrictive in terms of what treatments you had, the diagnoses that you had in the DSM, and so forth. And I think the earliest things I can remember is even from the youngest age, just having that extra creativity and energy boost, which was really amazing. I think for me it was really empowering because during the manic phase, as they have basically shared, is like being Superman. I've never taken ecstasy, but I would think that's really how it feels, even above that. So tons of energy, you're processing information really, really quickly, really, really fast. Yes, you do get irritable, but in my case, it wasn't so bad until I got a bit older, and this would be sec one, sec two. I was doing really well in school, really well in sports, very overloaded schedule in hindsight. Locally, I was going to what you would call an elite school. So pressure was really, really high amongst everyone. I went to St. Joseph's Institution, so if you're wondering, and I think that pressure just slowly built, and with the combination of the disorder starting to become more prevalent, especially around puberty as well, I think that's where it got a bit worse. And so what I started to have is I started to have the mood swings here and there, and then I started to get towards the point where I would have triggers. They weren't really super crazy at that time. In the beginning, they were short kind of stints of mania, then short stints of depression. But it got to a point where when stress really was building up, school started to really build up really hard. And pressures, I mean, when you're a teen, it's hard, right? You're dealing with girls, you're dealing with your schoolmates, you're dealing with your teachers, you're dealing with your parents, you're trying to find the identity that you are. And it's hard. I mean, even as a regular teenager, it's hard. We can all remember that, I think, in the room at one point. And it got to a point where I reached my final exams, I think, in sec one, and I just completely was burnt out. I blacked out, final exam, couldn't function, couldn't think of anything, couldn't do anything. Was barely, I would say, functioning, going through the motions. And that was a bit scary because I knew that I knew the answers to the paper, but nothing was coming out. So I took a bit of a break. I was fortunate enough to be pushed to Sec 2 based on merit for the year. And then the same thing happened in Sec 2. Got to the final exams, blanked out. And so that was tough. In short, we started some intervention with the school counselors. But again, at that time, you have to realize that it was really hard to diagnose. Well, first of all, and second of all, the treatment journey for the majority of individuals was very restricted. So even the counselors at that time were pretty much trained to kind of look at problems or symptoms like myself as people who just couldn't deal with the high pressure stress. And I think for them as well, in a upper tier school, are more leaning towards wanting to maintain the reputation of the school, but also to kind of pigeonhole students into saying it's stress, because yes, a lot of times it is stress. And I think as a teen, again, who knows that you have a mental health issue, right? So I then took a short break, and I think that was a longer break because after that, I had a short manic episode, if I remember correctly, of 2 months. And for me, biologically, I tend to be towards the depressive side of things. So I would have a manic, my episodes are typically from 2 weeks to 2 months. And then my depressive phase lasts anywhere from 4 months to the longest, I think, was 8 months of super bad chronic depression. So it's something that I wouldn't wish on my worst enemy, I would say. Stuck in bed, basically almost catatonic, I would say. So it's really scary. And the thing about it is, when you do recover, you're basically a baby because you're coming back out of your shell, and you really have to learn how to socialize again. And at that time, I think it was pretty hard because the rest of your classmates have no idea what's going on, right? Everyone's pretty scared and kind of has to deal with their own kind of thing as they're also going through life. So learning to socialize again is really hard because obviously you can't socialize or you can't make friends if you don't know how to socialize, right? So it's a cycle of what do we do? How do we get there? And I think I'm pretty fortunate to be a very headstrong and very positive individual just by nature. And so I think the other scary thing is what happens when you finish your episodes is as you're trying to learn how to socialize again, you lose the baseline of what emotions are, right? So let's say you go to therapy or whatever, you go to a psychologist or psychiatrist, they're like, okay, you're manic depressive, you have this scale, you have this spectrum. But what they don't tell you is you totally forget, are you really happy or are you manic? Are you really sad or are you depressive? And so you're always on this kind of lottery, teetering lever system where you're trying to figure out, are you really feeling an emotion or is it your episode? And I think for me, it's really, for me, my condition is not so much about triggers, but it's really heavy biologically with my neurochemistry. And so I'm on mood stabilizers. I'm on 3 different types of mood stabilizers. I have tried antidepressants before, but they swing me into mania. So unfortunately, can't take those. But the other thing about mood stabilizers is they give you a baseline. And so at the beginning, you're very monotonous. And so you're trying to relearn how to feel in that sense. And it does take time. It's pretty scary. I think the whole thing is really scary in that sense. But you do over time learn, okay, so this is happiness, this is sadness, this is being excited. And then slowly you start to fill out this pie chart or rainbow spectrum of, okay, so these are the emotions. And then when it swings to either side, that's mania, that's depression. Okay, these are the warning signs, these are the triggers, right? But other than that, everything that's been said prior to me speaking is true. Routine is really important. Sleep is really important. Having a support system is really important as well. And let me just take out my notes very quickly. So I tend to go off track. But I think at the end of the day, treatment has to, we can say everything there about treatment, right? But we also have to realize that when you're treating these individuals and you're taking care of these individuals, you're not just taking care of a patient, you're taking care of a unique person. You're taking care of a human who lives through their obstacles, who has their ups and downs, who's just the same as you. And at the end of the day, they're just living with something that changes their lives in a slightly different way, right? But yeah, I'm really big into Stoicism and Zen. So if you are a fan of those, you'll realize that yes, mindfulness is really great because it gives you an external perspective of where you are in the world and where you are in life in general. And it helps you zoom out and put some filters in. Stoicism is really great as well because it is a very pragmatic and practical form of philosophy that also in its sense has 4 main pillars, which means every decision you make goes through 4 filters, right? And if you don't know what they are, very shortly, the 4 main values of Stoicism are justice, wisdom, moderation, and courage. So every decision that I tend to make goes through those 4 pillars, and if they don't, it helps me slow down my decision-making, which is great if you're in a manic phase or you're not sure what you want to do. But at the same time, it also makes sure that I am making the right decisions. So if you're wondering how I got diagnosed, essentially, at the end of sec 2, when I had that burnout, when I had that depressive episode, I think that was the 8-month one, I was at home and one day I was watching the Oprah show actually on TV, and they had, and coincidentally, the episode was on bipolar disorder. And I was like, oh, this actually kind of matches up all what these people are talking about. And at that time, I was at the CGC, the Child Guidance Clinic. So if you're below 18 and you're exhibiting mental health symptoms, you get referred to the Child Guidance Clinic. And for me, that was SGH. Again, really hard to diagnose, right? And for bipolar disorder, the crazy thing is you do have existing mental health disorders layered in front as symptoms, right? So you need to get through those symptoms and then get through the underlying cause. So it was really hard to diagnose, but then I floated it out to my psychiatrist at the time. And she's like, okay, yeah, sure, let's try medication and see whether it works. And so we did, and there was an effect there. And yeah, I mean, I hit the lottery, I guess, with that. And from there, it was just basically, yeah, just trying to live with the diagnosis, to realize that certain doors were closed permanently. I grew up in a military family. And so my goal was either to go into the Air Force or to go into military intelligence. But unfortunately, if you have a mental health diagnosis, you can't get security clearance to do either in Singapore. So for me, that was pretty soul crushing. But at the same time, I think, like I said, I'm very headstrong, pretty stubborn, and pretty positive. So I've always thought that regardless of where you are in life, if you're willing to take the next step forward, regardless of how big or how small it is, you're going to be okay. And I think that philosophy has helped me pretty well, because I'm in an industry that I love. I was a former professional gamer. I am a current esports commentator, and I think I was pretty lucky because straight out of the army, it took me about 7 years to complete secondary school due to various health issues and administrative errors and misunderstandings. But essentially, I went straight into the army after that, and after that, I got hired by my dream company, even before I OIP from the military, from the army. So I think that was pretty cool because at the age of 24, I was already an executive. And this is in a huge contrast to going from SGI into a neighborhood school just to finish O levels as quickly as possible, failing a couple of subjects, being so worried from my principal, my teachers, what are you going to do? The only course you can take is nursing and IT. And I basically said, hey, you know, I'm it's going to be all right. Yeah, I'm willing to take the next step. And I think it's pretty funny because everyone's always so nervous around exams and at that time, and they were freaking out, and I'm like, why, right? But I think I unfortunately have a very different opinion of the world and how to approach things and the perspectives you need to move forward in life. I don't think many people have that, unfortunately, and I think in Singapore it's very different. Because it is an Asian culture, Asian society, society, and it's very much conservative. I think back in the day, some of the horror stories I had in my neighborhood school were, you know, during Chinese New Year, parents were locking up their kids with mental issues, mental health issues, in the house, so that they were so ashamed of having a kid who had these issues. And I think it's crazy. I grew up in the States, so I think I had that kind of Western influence, and now with the world's a lot more global and self-care, mental health is on the rise, and we're having different treatments. But I mean, we're still pretty far behind in terms of the restrictions we have in Singapore and some of the advancements and treatments that you have around the world. Hopefully that will change in the future. You know, especially with experimental treatments and some of the work that they're doing with psychedelics in the States and Israel and whatnot. But yeah, I think that's about it for me. I think the Q&A will be, I know I have some people starting to doze off, so I like to keep it. That's why I usually have a Q&A, so it's a bit more organic. Don't worry, you can rest. You probably have had a very hard workload. So I empathize with all my doctors here. It's been pretty crazy over the pandemic. I mean, even for me to get an appointment, it was a 6 month wait typically. It's now down to maybe 3 months. But yeah, it's always great to work with these guys. You know, I've been stable pretty much for 12 years now, I think, slightly longer than that, maybe 15. Time just goes by when you're having fun, right? But yeah, I think we have almost been there after that. I'll stick around for a bit afterwards. We'll have the Q&A as well. So feel free to shoot questions that you have. But at the end of the day, just wrap everything up. I think we can all take a page out of people who have mental health issues, because I think all of us at some point in life go through these obstacles, maybe not as extreme as some others, but you know, we either have someone who goes through them, know someone who goes through them, or we ourselves at some point, maybe not now, you might develop something, regardless of how big or how small they are. And I think the most important part is just to realize that there is always a way forward. People care about you, and we're all humans. Yeah. So thank you very much for listening to me drone on. And I don't know who's next. So Vera's next. Sorry, what's your name? Vera. All right, so Vera's going to take over, and we'll see you in the Q&A in a bit. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think thank you for staying till the tail end of this forum. Maybe you all want to take a big stretch and just really thank you for just staying to the tail end. And I'm sure that you have benefited from the speakers before. So in my segment, I'm Vera. I'm a medical social worker and family therapist from the Mood Disorders Unit. In my segment, I'd like to take a family perspective in speaking about bipolar disorder, because I think everyone can agree that just as how the symptoms affect everyone, so should the treatment involve everyone. So some of the interventions that you've heard before this are largely targeted to the individual with bipolar disorder. So in my talk, I'd like to offer some tips for the journey for other people that are involved in the care of our patients. So the first area that I'll cover will be the impact of bipolar disorder on the family system. Four common situations that I see in my work that create tensions in families. And finally, how do families support each other at different phases of the illness? Okay. So taking a family perspective of bipolar disorder means that we acknowledge that the illness affects not only the affected individual, but the family system. Many family members that I work with describe this experience to be like that on an emotional roller coaster. So many family members share with me that there's often no one state to get used to. There are the extreme highs of mania, and on the other end, the lows of depression. And unlike the roller coaster that we sit on that comes to an eventual halt, many family members managing bipolar disorder do not always have an end in sight, because episodes are often acute and recurrent. Many family members report severe anxiety, constantly anticipating that symptoms will recur and there'll be a relapse. And sometimes, because of the behaviors during manic phase, right, some of the experiences the family goes through can be traumatic. On the family front, staying involved in social activities with your wider social circle may sometimes take a backseat, because there is little mood for fun and the desire to connect, because you're already having a lot on your plate, adjustments and crisis to handle as a family. Then there is also overnight changes of roles in the family when a loved one is ill. Sometimes spouses turn into primary caregivers overnight, and our children in the family inevitably having to step up to take care of another sibling because a parent is now ill. Due to mood fluctuations and the occasional need to be hospitalized, maintaining a consistent work performance and an output, right, can feel like a challenge. And if a patient is the primary sole breadwinner in the family, there could be financial losses when there's loss of function and ability to work. Okay. So this slide is my attempt to put to you how mania and depression specifically affects relationships. So this is mania. Okay. So in mania, our loved ones can be experienced by others as more disagreeable and insensitive. They may alienate employers, romantic partners, family members with arrogance or irritability. In mania, the person can also develop ideas that you find hard to support and connect with. So for example, someone having an overnight idea about committing their family savings into a business idea that as a family member you've never heard before. So it will be your first time hearing about it, and understandably hard for you to align with it. To make it more complicated, the person in mania can be less receptive to advice and concern. So getting a word in would feel tough. There is also in this phase, risk-taking behaviors that threaten the feelings of safety in the family. destructive behaviors like aggressiveness, inappropriate sexual behavior, uncontrolled spending, binge drinking, and even alcohol and drug use. So on the whole, right, there's raised levels of anxiety, stress, and just a period of disorganization in the family system. And then there's depression. Okay, so when there's depression, right, the individual has trouble enjoying time together, there's a diminished energy to engage in joint intimacy, and even having the reduced ability to engage in conflict resolution, communicating. So basically, there's a general sense of gloom and worry in the family. And sometimes when our loved ones experience suicidal thinking, right, it can be very anxiety provoking. So as you can see here, right, there is just a lot of, because of during mania time, they might unknowingly push away family members, and during depression time, they might want to shut in. So really getting a social support system going well for someone with bipolar disorder can feel very tough. At this point, I just want to also say that these behaviors that I have spelled out are hard to control, and believe it or not, I have many patients that share with me that, hey Vera, you know, I feel guilty, I feel embarrassed, and I do live with regret for some of the things I've done, right? And what's worse, sometimes I cannot remember about these events, so processing with my family can feel very tough. Yeah, so just wanted to say that while these behaviors are put out there, right? These behaviors are things that our loved ones with bipolar, they really struggle, and there's a lot of sometimes shame and guilt that they bear as well. So four common situations leading to tension in families that I see in my work. Okay, so the first one being the inaccurate attribution of the illness, which shows up when families either over-identify or under-identify. Let me explain. Okay. So in over-identification of the illness, so what I mean is that this usually happens when the last period of illness was quite traumatic for the person and the family. So while it is understandable, but it is also an inaccurate way of looking at our loved one and the illness. So in this situation, family members might view all of the person's problems, emotional reaction, viewpoints, attitudes, habits, behaviors as part of the disorder. So there's a crippling fear of the disorder's power over the person. And then when we are fearful, what do? We impose severe restrictions on the patient to ward off future damage, right? So if you look at this diagram, right? So a lot of, it'll be really, the illness would be quite dominated. And then the person that you might not be able to see that, you know, ultimately this patient is really still in him or her, right? But the illness, the picture of the illness just comes forth, right? So this becomes problematic because you would be seeing the person as more ill than they actually are. And then how does it reflect, result in conflicts, right? Your loved one may then resist your help, and he or she will be frustrated for being constantly viewed for their illness and not for them. Next one, under identification with the illness, right? So that's the other end, right? In this case, usually family members might doubt that the illness is real, right? Attributing illness, the symptoms and behavior to the person's personality or the morals or just their attitude or the lack of effort, right? There's the belief that the patient has more control over the mood swings than they actually do. Then the illness is discounted and there's a pressure on the person to perform like before. Once again, under identification with the illness could be a coping for some families, but you know, once again, it is inaccurate. And then it can be problematic as it causes conflicts and then pressure on the person with bipolar disorder. Okay. The second scenario that I often see is the over-monitoring of emotional temperature in the family. So while it is right that we should take our emotional temperature regularly because it helps us notice our emotion, right, before it gets to a dangerous point, but we shouldn't over-monitor. Right, because when there's over-monitoring of emotional temperature at home, there's excessive worry. You know, are medications taken? Did he sleep enough? Oh no, he doesn't want to go for that appointment, right? So the whole climate there would be, you don't trust me. So that can also lead to conflicts and just a lot of quarrels. Okay, and then there is non-adherence to medication and treatment, right? So I believe at some point in the course of illness, patients, including families, they do think about whether medications is really useful and helpful or whether it's needed. So it is common to hear the following. I feel fine now, so why do I need medication? My medications don't work. They cause me side effects, right? Others may claim that they enjoy the high of hypomania and don't want to take the medication because it will end up feeling the loss of euphoria. Taking medications means admitting I have an illness. And hey, what do you mean taking my medications regularly? Do you know what side effects I get from it? So while there are pros and cons to taking medication, my patients with bipolar have really taught me that it's so important to stay the course. So when I say stay the course, we mean to keep on your medications, right? And if your loved one is not adhering to them, can we talk to them about the adverse side effects? Get them to raise the adverse side effects to their doctors, really, instead of arguing with them, to try to empathize where they come from, and really to talk to the doctors about whether, you know, can we change in terms of the strength of the dose, the timing, and how can we adjust it such that it is elevated, the side effects are elevated or minimized to a tolerable level. And then the fourth scenario, problems with intimacy and trust between partners. So many spouses and partners, they feel angry about events that occurred in the illness episode. This could be due to how the illness is poorly managed, medications were skipped, or how there was something done, right, against your spouse's wishes. Very often, physical and sexual intimacy may have stopped altogether during or shortly after one's last episode of mania and depression. Many couples then report that basic issues of trust were violated by their early illness states and how emotional and physical intimacy can be hard to re-establish. In scenarios like this, it is quite likely that the medical team will then refer the couple, right, to a family therapist, and that's how I might get involved, and to work out some issues in the family sessions, right, to try to improve the overall couple functioning. And that's how I come to know about one. This is one key area of struggle in families dealing with bipolar disorder. Okay, so now tips for the journey. If I were to break up this journey of caregiving, of illnesses along the illness spectrum, right? So therefore, the first one, the pre-diagnosis phase before our loved one is diagnosed. The second is when we just receive a diagnosis. The third one, the acute phase. And then finally, the maintenance phase. So under acute, if you see the pink boxes, right, it's about managing hospitalizations and relapses, right? And then also under maintenance phase, I'll be talking about post-acute, when the person comes out of hospital, right, the continuation phase, and finally recovery and maintenance. So I've looked at, and as you can see, I've connected the acute phase and the maintenance phase because of the recurring nature of this bipolar illness. Okay, and then I'll also run through some day-to-day support that cuts across the four phases. And just for the clinicians in our midst, I think it's also important to keep in view that, that different illness phases have different goals of treatment. So acute recovery and maintenance have different goals. So let's pay attention to that. Okay. So why a family-based approach to bipolar disorder? So for many patients with bipolar disorder, due to the recurring nature of the illness and mood fluctuations, they require parents, family members, spouses to provide the stability that their internal world does not provide, right? And literature also does show that there's considerable evidence that family-focused treatment, when administered alongside medications in the post-episode, can delay recurrences, reduce symptom severity, and improve medication adherence. Other reasons why family members should be included in this journey, first of all, you know, you guys live with the patient, and as the patient becomes ill or when there's medication side effects, right, you get to notice it first. You can also help your loved one to take medication, stay on a regular sleep cycle, and limit drinking habits. Even if your relationship with your loved one with bipolar disorder is not great, right, staying involved can help the clinician treating your loved one understand the environment at home, the environment of the patient, before recommending any treatment. So in the pre-diagnosis phase, so in every of the four phases, you'll see two columns. Okay, so on one side, I'll talk about the struggle. And then on the other, I'll recommend some tips for the journey about how you can support. Okay. So for the struggle, in this pre-diagnosis phase, right, your loved one may not recognize their own symptoms as mania and depression, right? Therefore, denial and resistance to help is common. There's also, in this case, for the person with bipolar disorder, a lot of fear. The fear of being associated or being ill, including being stigmatized, or just the fact that when I'm ill, I have to be on long-term medication, or I have to be hospitalized, I have to opt out for certain activities, right? These are very hard to acknowledge. And for families in this space, a lot of them tells me, oh, Vera, I don't know where to go. Should I start at the polyclinic? Should I go to a private hospital? Or do I just send my loved one to IMH immediately? Right? So not knowing where to go for help. So in this space, when things are uncertain and unclear, right, you also knowing your family members might be resistant, right? You want to speak calmly and give observations, explain why you think that they need more help. So for example, I might see in my loved one some symptoms. So I might say, you know, I'm seeing differences in you, and it's my job as your mom, as your dad, to point that out. And I hope you can accept my opinion, right? And instead of saying, no, you're ill, let's bring you to IMH, right? Your cousin also went, let's go and get an evaluation. Maybe you can just suggest a general medical check instead of just being very forceful, right? So in this whole journey, we want to learn to be honest, but also gentle. We want to learn to validate the struggle that our loved ones might be feeling, right? And also for those families in this space, you know, it's important that we want to be open to getting help and not delay too long in consulting a medical professional. Okay, so the second phase, when we just receive a diagnosis. Okay, so the struggle here is really that, you know, after getting a diagnosis, a lot of families tell me, Vera, I feel scared. I don't know so many things, so overwhelming, right? What does it mean for me? What does it mean for my loved one? What does it mean for our future now that he or she is ill, right? So in this space, it's really about helping each other. So in a family of five, cannot be that, you know, all of us accept the illness at the same time, right? So different people will be at different points in accepting of this illness. So this phase, the struggle is really, how can we all get on board, right, and understand this illness together? So in this phase, like I said, information overload, grappling with new terms, new language, medical terms, right? And really, at this phase, a lot of families are also learning to trust their medical team, right? You're working with with professionals you don't even know before. Can I trust them with my loved one? So the support, right? In this phase, we really want to understand. Okay, since we are new to the illness, right, can we understand the symptoms and understand it through the lens of our loved one, right? Yes, you can go on checks on internet about what this is about, you know, attend a talk, but ultimately our loved ones live with the illness. What better way to get to know about the illness through them? What does the symptoms feel for them, right? And to give them time to fully accept, you know, so to not rush them to accept. Right, and to also be compassionate to yourself, right, giving your time to yourself and your other family members to accept that, okay, this is something new we're going through together, right? So reaching out for information, and also in this space, when things are very new, we want to make sure we have an accurate understanding of the illness to clarify the causes, right, and to understand treatment options. And let's also not forget the children in our midst, in our homes, right? So children who lives with a parent or a sibling with bipolar disorder, right? They know that their loved one is ill, right? And they have a lot of questions when someone in their family is sick. So each parent and child's beginning conversation about bipolar disorder will be different, right? It will depend on the child's age, the ability to manage information. And with bipolar disorder, because it's also quite complex, right? There's the highs of mania, the lows of depression. So sometimes people say, I don't know how to describe it, right? And then it becomes a secret in the family. So we want to start having conversations with our children at home, share age appropriate information on what is mental illness and what is bipolar disorder. And finally, having an action plan could really help our children after giving that information, right? So they know what to do. So examples of action plan, right? Sitting down with them, making a list of signs that tells them that when their parent or sibling is well, and also when it's not well, so that they can see the difference. Having a name and a contact of an adult who the child can call. Writing down questions and worries that the child have, and giving them the option to really call like 911 or the police if there's an emergency. if parent or sibling is hospitalized, I think it would be important that we also brief the children instead of assuming that, oh, they don't need to know or they don't know what's going on, right? To brief them about what they can expect and who will care for them in mommy and daddy's absence. So really, be ready to accept our children's emotions and answer their questions. So helping them understand what is going on will really worry them less. So moving out of the diagnosis phase, right? So we have to learn to manage acute mania, right? So during acute mania, right? I think all my colleagues have shared about what mania is about, so I'll keep it brief. But basically the support that we want to go into is really to not get into an argument or take the manic behaviors personally, right? So avoid telling persons going through mania. I think a lot of my patients tell me, don't tell me to calm down, you know, or don't tell me to relax. Yeah, because it's something that they just cannot physically control, right? And also in this phase, we want to avoid embarrassing them for not making sense, you know, or like putting down their ideas immediately. So still really being around to spend time with them so that we can watch out for them. And if agreed upon, if there was a contract before that, you know, to help safe keep their phones, their password, their social media accounts and credit cards. But please only do that if like you've had a pre-arranged agreement. Like, you know, when you see me in a bit of mania, right, maybe I would like to pass my things to you so that you can help me safeguard them. So in this phase, really encouraging medication, calling into the doctor and be open to hospitalization. And then there's the phase of acute depression, right? So the struggle here is really that our loved ones, like what my psychologist colleague Tammy just now shared, the struggle in the depressive phase would be that there's an inability to be productive. And then that can bring about feelings of guilt and inadequacy, which then reinforce the depressive feelings. So in this case, support would mean that we avoid talking about doing more, being productive, you know, and really to focus on attempts, right? So breaking big tasks, like, okay, you know, I want you to go to work, right? But can we celebrate the small tasks? Can we break it down for them, right? Who's going to kind of send the person to work, right? How do you even get out of bed? How do you get to just wash up, right? So breaking tasks into smaller bite-sized steps for them. And focusing on attempts and not the completion of the task. Yeah. So in this phase also, as loved ones, I think it'll be helpful if we don't take distance, withdrawal, and even suicidal thinking personally, right? Like, how can you do this to me? We've done so much for you. How can you even think like that? Why are you still depressed? Yeah, so I would avoid saying these things. Yeah, and really to learn to express concern and offer help while monitoring for safety. And then there's hospitalization. So this is a big one. Yeah, so a lot of family members tell me, Vera, you know, now that I'm in the ward, I'm admitted, what's next, right? Family members also ask that. Now my patient, my relative is in the hospital, what's next for us, right? There's a lot of sometimes anger and resentment in our loved ones if the admission was a forced one. Right? And then sometimes after staying there in the ward for like maybe 2 weeks, we also feel anxious. Loved ones can feel anxious about taking the patient home, right? And patients sometimes also don't feel ready to go home, right? And in this phase, there's also struggle about how do I explain to my relatives where my girl went to, you know, like where is she, right? So these things are all struggles, right? So the support really is that we want to work with the medical team during the inpatient stay to understand the purpose of inpatient treatment. So outpatient treatment and inpatient treatment are very different, right? So what is the point of keeping your relative in hospital maybe for like 2 weeks, right? What are we working on, right? So have a conversation with the medical team. And it is a difficult time. So self-regulation of your own emotions would be critical, though difficult. Also, we want to use the time in the ward. I mean, there are medical professionals there. Can we enlist the help of the social worker, you know, to talk about the most recent episode as a family? So really being able to talk about things like also, you know, what were the symptoms, you know, as a family sit down, you know, what were the symptoms that you're experiencing in your loved one that brought you in? What were some of the triggers that were just happening before the admission, right? Can we talk about that and process it together? Right. And really using this period, sometimes hospitalization is also kind of a short, unexpected break for the loved one, right? To really take care of yourself and to look into the needs of other family members. Okay, so coming out of hospital, the post-acute phase, I call it the continuation phase. So really at this period is the part that is after the period after resolution of acute symptoms, and the goal of this phase is to produce sustained recovery, right? So here, the struggle is often that you discharge home, you go home, right? There's side effects of medication, you continue to feel it, right? And then, so it's important that a lot of times people, like what Mr. Phil said just now, it takes time to recover. You know, you're still a bit groggy, you're still a bit feeling a bit sensitive and heightened, right? And it's so difficult to resume function. So in this phase, sometimes after mania, depression can also follow. So the whole recovery journey can feel so long. Right, so for family members in this phase, right, when your loved one just came out of hospital, right, can we develop together a mania or a suicide prevention plan? So really writing it out, like, you know, so when I see you this way, right, what are things that you can do? What can I do, right? And can we understand your role and my role? What's the difference? Can we agree that when I see you doing this, you can pass me your phone, your social media accounts, having a talk like that. So understanding what are the early warning signs, right, and what do we do when we see something bigger happens. So in this period, we want to produce, remember I said, sustained recovery. So monitoring of the climate at home is also important, managing the stress level and temperature in the family. And really this period, you know, if your loved one has, you know, bipolar disorder, like homework from their psychologist, right, maintaining consistency with mood tracking, with medication regime, and really helping, right, for patients with depression, can we help to schedule some pleasant events, you know, that they can look forward to, that they can go out to do, right, as part of behavior activation. Yeah. Okay. So in the maintenance phase, there's also recovery. So when I talk about recovery, the definition would be thinking about a picture where we want to stay relapse-free, right? There's improving of, the focus will be improving quality of life and working on some illness-related issues that during the acute phase, you may not be focused on working on. So things like resolving marital issues, family, parenting problems, and dealing with like stigma, right? So these are issues that in the acute phase, you kind of like, it's not the priority, right? So in the recovery phase, we want to look at things like improving quality of life and just re-entering new or pre-existing roles, vocational, going back to work, you know, going back to certain roles that I was holding before. Yeah. So in the recovery phase, the support that we want to give to our loved ones is really to notice early warning signs of recurrence, potential triggers, and even what are stressful periods for our loved ones, right? So knowing that, so that we can be alert to like when there might be a relapse. As a family, we also want to model good nightly and daily routines and really to encourage function and easing into the roles again for our loved one. As a family, we also want to be encouraging your loved one to practice stress management skills and being open, right, to go for therapy with your loved one if there's a need. So something that cuts across all the different phases that I just want to mention would be, it is so important that we want to value the person over the progress, right? Considering bipolar disorder is something that reoccurs from in the person's lifetime, right? We want to remember that while progress can feel very difficult to attain, right? We want to value the person before the illness, right? And so also in the midst of illness, can we also find joys, like, you know, family routines and all activities that we were doing together before the illness and to really engage in family activities. And so also remember, right, be mindful of stigma, to treat the person with the illness like one of you. A lot of my patients tell me, you know, Vera, after I fall sick, right, my parents start to treat me like yeah, they constantly monitor me, I'm already 28, you know, but they treat me like I'm 8 years old, you know, and things like that. So a lot of times the person feels really undermined. So it's important that we also not want to unknowingly stigmatize our loved ones. Okay. And also encouraging any function, any return to function, no matter how small, right? Being able to celebrate the small milestones and just the fact that the person is returning to function. And important thing is to keep strengthening the relationship between each other, right? Because the illness can really change the relationships, right? So protecting that relationship, spending time and strengthening it, that's really important, building up the trust and the connection. And finally, allowing conversations, not only the just focusing on the progress, the celebrations, but allow room for the struggle, right? Can we talk? Can we allow space and to talk about the struggle? What's difficult? What am I scared of, right? And not just the good things. And as a caregiver, right, even the patient, right, can we prioritize our own self-care and mental wellness? Yeah, so just to summarize, in the four phases, for the first phase, right, pre-diagnosis, we want to recognize. Okay, there are 4 R's, okay? So the first one is recognize. Recognize symptoms early, the need for help and treatment. In the after getting a diagnosis, we want to reach out, right? Reach out for knowledge. Reach out to our loved one to understand the symptoms from them. Reach out to the medical team and to others for a better understanding of the illness. We want to get clarity. So let's reach out. In the acute phase, we want to learn. When things are so stressful, we want to learn to respond instead of react. We want to respond with calm, right, with preparedness instead of reacting. Already things are so disorganized and stressful, right? So can we move away from reacting but to respond? Finally, in the maintenance phase, right, recovery. What is recovery? Can we rebuild with our loved one their lives? That includes the roles and relationships that they value. So that is really recovery, right? When they can go back to things that they value, that they enjoy. And something, the final R that I think cut across all, once again, is your relationship with the person, right? We really need one to strengthen and also remember the relationship you have with the person that you are trying to help, right? So what's the point of going through all this, right, when the relationship is not strong? So let's focus in this illness journey to value this relationship that you have with our loved ones. Yes, so I mentioned just now, just as the symptoms affect everyone, so should the treatment involve everyone. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Dara. Maybe now invite the speakers back on stage for the Q&A session.